Hey guys, it's Steve O'Brien. Steve O'Brien with FBG Live. Hey, we're going to be talking a lot about history today. And, you know, we've been traveling down all sorts of Texas history trails. And so I dug somebody up that's going to talk about a little bit of the history of Texas as he's seen it. And he studies it a lot. And maybe even talk to us about how it's applied in today's Texas. I'd like to welcome you guys all to Bob Wilson. Bob, are you there?
Yes, I'm here.
Well, thanks for joining us. So let's just say that I don't know anything about Texas history. What is Texas?
Okay, Texas is a land. And in its beginnings, Texas was a part of the Republic of Mexico, as it was known at that time in the 1830s.
Okay.
And they didn't call it Texas. They may have referred to Tejas, this or that territory. And the reason they had it was because when Mexico declared its independence from Spain, Spain, after a long time and a lot of money and bloodshed, decided to just let them be independent rather than spend more money and more lives.
Okay, so at that point, it was two different nations, Tejas and Mexico, or how were
it was Mexico, which included in its lands from Spain was the area north of the Rio Grande River, and it didn't have a name, but some people referred to it as Tejas.
Okay.
Tejas territory.
So how did it end up? It ended up forming into this thing called Texas, right? And it was a nation before it was a state. Is that correct?
That's right. Very quickly, Mexico had encouraged its citizens to move north of the Rio Grande and do homesteading, which meant farming, in this area that wasn't populated. When that didn't get enough people to defend each other against the savage Comanches, then they invited people from the U.S. or United States of America at that time to come down, and they'd give them some land and maybe a little grub stake and get them started. And so for quite a long, several decades, there were Americans and Mexicans homesteading, you know, in the same area, defending each other, probably going to dances together and whatever, you know.
Right.
But this was rough times, and they were surviving together. Mm-hmm. That's what's leading up to it. Now, a new president's elected in Mexico, and his last name is Santa Anna. He's got three or four other names before that. And it turns out he doesn't like these Americans. In fact, he's got a real problem with them.
Okay, so they were first invited over, and then, you know, the new president was elected, and then just like, I don't want them.
And he decided to get them out of there. Now, it turns out that President Santa Anna was known mainly as a military general for Mexico. And so within a short time of being elected president, he declared himself dictator of Mexico, which was a brand new republic, and declared its constitution abolished.
So Mexico was a republic before it was...
Yes.
Oh, interesting. So is it some kind of a democratically elected thing, or how did...
Yeah, they had elections and so on.
Wow, cool.
But not after Santa Anna, because he made himself dictator. He headed up the army. Who's going to fight him?
Okay.
You know, so he had delusions of grandeur, and he had an army to back it up. And his hot button was Americans in area that he thought now belonged to him personally as king.
Okay.
And dictator. Yeah, and so he proceeded to send his armies up there, and when they weren't effective enough at driving out the Americans, he came up to this area we call Texas, which was merely a part of Mexico and a largely unpopulated area. It was unnamed. And then he took charge of the armies, and the first big showdown was at something everybody in the world has heard of called the Alamo, which was just an original Spanish mission. It was a little church.
Right.
Even though anybody recognizes the front profile now, they, you know, then it was just another Spanish mission or church. And they were defending it because it was kind of the center of where the American population was, and they considered it a fort by them, a fort that the settlers, farmers, could flee to in the event of either Indian attacks or other attacks. You with me?
I'm going with you.
Yeah, so that didn't work out so well, even though, you know, Davy Crockett and a number of other good men from the War of 1812 and other wars, experienced soldiers, even though they came down there, they were outnumbered, you know, 10 or 20 to 1, and they finally lost. They killed every one of them except one wife, and they sent her to tell on foot to tell the rest of the Americans to get out of his area, his country. The next showdown was at a little town around Goliad, called Goliad. And there they surrendered to him, but in the end, I mean, they surrendered under the white flag. A couple of days later, he had them all shot,
right?
Men, women, and children.
So Santa Ana was...
Yeah, Santa Ana had them slaughtered. Well, that really got the dander of all of America up, and a flood of American volunteers came down. And General Sam Houston was named head of the Provisional or Continental Army, whatever it was, and had various names. And Santa Ana's strategy was to retreat behind a river and wait for old Santa Ana. Did that about six times because we had a lot of rivers that fed into the Gulf. In the end, he got across the San Jacinto River. That's where Santa Ana met his Waterloo, you know, not to mix the metaphors here. Because by then, Santa Ana was too far, too skinny of a supply line, and he was on boggy, swampy ground where his mounted cavalry couldn't decimate the infantry, and he lost. And now, at that point, in 1836... Santa Ana is captured by Houston's scout named Deaf Smith. He was called Deaf because he was. And at Swords Point, Santa Ana agreed to sign a treaty releasing the land north of the San Jacinto River to the people who lived on it, whether they were Americans or Mexicans, which was the only way Santa Ana could save his life. And a treaty was signed, and it stands to this very day. And he agreed not to encroach on that territory or send troops across. So the provisional government down in Houston area was already well along towards forming a nation. They had already written a Declaration of Independence for Mexico, et cetera. And what followed was Sam Houston was elected president, first president. Mm-hmm. Now, it was called the Republic of Texas. There are thousands and thousands of documents. In fact, around Austin, Texas, there are thousands of cubic feet of the actual original records in boxes and files stored in various buildings.
Oh, really?
And we are surveying those as we speak.
What are you doing with all the surveying? Are you cataloging, indexing, and uploading them for public access?
We aren't that far yet. We're scanning. We're just skimming through first to see what is relevant today.
Okay.
Yeah. So that's how Texas became a nation. And you become a nation two ways.
Okay, so let me sidetrack you a little bit.
Yeah.
So what did that new republic look like? You know, so did it break down Texas into districts and have a governor's office? And what was the control mechanism? Was it a top-down mm-hmm. or bottom-up? And what were the roles in between?
Well, yeah, it was a republic. And largely, for lack of a better model, they modeled themselves after the United States of America. In fact, their constitution looks surprisingly like the United States America Constitution. There were some differences.
Okay.
At any rate, there was a president-elect, a vice president, a Supreme Court, the whole nine yards, everything that the U.S. had. Okay?
Okay.
And instead of states, because remember, a state is just another word for a nation.
Okay.
They mean the same place, but state is often referring to the government of that nation, whereas nation refers to the people and the land. Okay, so we didn't have states, we had counties, and there were only about 20 of them, and they covered everything from the Rio Grande all the way to Wyoming, you know, which included parts of New Mexico, Colorado, Oklahoma, Kansas, and Wyoming. That's the land we won from Santa Anna. And that outline is what you see on our medallions made of silver, gold, and copper today. Is that outline of the nation as it was.
I've seen one of those. They're really nice.
Mm-hmm.
What does it look like today as opposed to when it was a republic of Texas?
Okay. When it was a republic, it was governed according to the Constitution and laws, and politics existed, but it wasn't a big deal at that time. What it is today, today, Texas is still a republic, and we consider it an occupied nation. It's occupied by U.S. forces. Now they got all kinds of three-letter designations, you know.
Right.
But it is a nation, and yet today, being occupied, we have to give in on certain things.
Right.
But the fact that it's a nation is proven by the fact that all of Texas lands are still recorded in a general land office, which is still in Austin, Texas.
Hmm.
Now, the 49 states of the U.S. have one general land office in Virginia, right outside of D.C. In other words, everybody else has to have their land recorded by D.C. We don't. Ours is all recorded in Austin, Texas, always has been, always will be. And our land in Texas is, the land records are not in the U.S.
Hmm.
Also, if you walk into the Capitol Rotunda, what does it say on the floor? In terrazzo and fancy stones, it says the Republic of Texas. That hasn't changed.
So have you seen an increase of people wanting to talk about Texas as a republic?
Oh, definitely. Tremendously. We get contacts on our website. We get phone calls. I handle the phone calls regarding the press, and a writer for the Atlantic Monthly called and did an hour interview because he's writing a very extensive article for that magazine, national magazine, about the Republic of Texas.
Yeah. Yeah.
There's a tremendous interest. We're getting interest from places way outside of the U.S., way outside of North America. A lot of inquiries.
I've actually heard a lot of my listeners talking to me about various forms of we should just leave. And I'm like, okay, cool, you know. And I do know you guys have studied, you know, the actual ingress of the state of Texas into the former Republic of the United States. There were some sticky points in there, too, if I remember right. Texas wasn't even ratified. How did that go?
Well, here's just a 1, 2, 3 thing quickly.
Bullet. Don't have much time.
One was the Republic of Texas had huge debts because of the cost of the War of Independence from Mexico. In other words, other countries loaned them money. I suppose France did, and anybody who didn't like England, you know. And maybe even England loaned money, but that's all being rooted out. So eventually, the subject of becoming part of the United States was brought up. The Senate of the Texas Republic drafted an offer of treaty to become part of the United States.
Mm-hmm.
And that was after being invited by some delegate from the United States. That was taken to the U.S., considered by the U.S. Senate, which, of course, Senates handle all international matters. The House is primarily responsible for domestic matters. The Senate voted against it more than 2-1, voted it down. It was dead. So no treaty. Well, a while later, the House of Representatives comes up with a resolution. Now, resolutions are used to say, let's make this Mother's Day. Let's start this holiday called Mother's Day, you know, President's Day. That's what resolutions are for. Or a resolution on how we're going to conduct the business of the House. This one was to annex Texas. And it was bitterly debated against by most of the representatives. But two House of Representative reps came down, visited with the newly elected president of the Texas Republic, whose name was Anson Jones. And they convinced him that that was in the best interests and they were going to make it easy for us. A series of negotiations followed, but Anson Jones was forbidden by the Republic of Texas Constitution to enter into any agreements. It's not his to do. The president doesn't have that authority in the Republic. He sent horseback riders out to tell the newly elected Congress, don't bother to come down here for the Congress this year because we are working on becoming part of the U.S. Again, that was unlawful because that authority did not exist in his job description.
He dissolved Congress?
No, he just told them not to meet. Wow. Instead, a committee was formed. Unfortunately, the majority of people on the committee didn't live in Texas, which, according to the Constitution, forbids them having any dealings with the nation. In other words, they couldn't be, but they populated that committee with people from Louisiana and Tennessee and whatever, you know, because they were on the side of the U.S. Well, this was a, what do you call this? Let's just ram this thing through. And eventually they got it through. The trouble is it was done in fraud. There's no statute of limitations on fraud, so the whole thing is invalid. And we really aren't part of the U.S. However, we're under military occupation, not to mention the EPA and the ATF and all the other people that, you know, occupy us. So, and people were dumbed down in the U.S. government control schools to believe that we were a state of the Union and they were citizens of the U.S. The U.S. has done that everywhere. They're doing it today.
Right.
They did it to the Philippines. They did it to Hawaii. Come on, you know, it's just a pattern that the U.S. has. The U.S. is totally out of control.
Right.
The whole world knows it, and the whole world dislikes the U.S. government.
Hey, do they follow their Constitution, the United States of America?
No, not in the slightest. In fact, to them, it's just an overlay. They are a registered corporation, for profit, a corporation doing commerce with the world, and they make their rules as any corporation does. The CEO is called Obama, and their rules are corporate rules. It's just like if General Electric, you got GE and you got US, they're both corporations. General Electric makes a rule for all its employees and officers, then those guys have to follow it.
Right.
But the consumers of GE products do not have to follow it. Mm-hmm. They're not under it. Okay? The same difference here.
Right. So, taking that model, Texas is a corporate entity. Is that correct?
Texas, the state, yes, is a corporate entity. It's a sub-corporation of the U.S. Incorporated.
And is different than the Republic of the United States. Oh, I'm sorry, the Republic of Texas.
All it is a corporation claiming to be the government of Texas, a greatly shrunken Texas, because in connection with that annexation, they took away a huge percentage of our nation and, created other states out of it, such as New Mexico and So, you know, parts of it were put into Oklahoma, parts into, like I said, Colorado, Kansas, and Wyoming. Any rate, the thing in Austin is a business corporation functioning, well, you know, calling themselves, acting like, appearing like a government, but they're there for profit, and that's why they get away with so much. One glaring one is not only the Republic Constitution, but the state of Texas Constitution absolutely forbids ad valorem taxes. Your property taxes on your home and land are ad valorem. That's forbidden by the Constitution. They've never changed it. And yet they collect the property taxes at the point of a gun. If you don't pay them, they kick you out of your house and sell it.
Wow.
Okay?
Yeah.
Now, that's a business corporation operating at it in its normal mode. That's what they do down there. Now, I don't dislike the people, because the people are as dumbed down in the government of the state of Texas as everybody has been for 150 years.
The crazy part that I see is that everybody's operating under this construct that we're under the United States Constitution, and we're under the Constitution of our state. Currently, we're talking about our state, Texas, and where our governments do not act under the Constitution. In fact, they have a legal system that judges everything completely different. And you can, I've asked people on the street, I've been constantly asking this question, do we follow the Constitution? I have yet to get a yes. And I'm sure I'll get one eventually, but you know, but people will still think, you know, well, let's let the system play itself out. But you guys don't think like that over there, right? You've been, how long you the Republic of Texas been together as a nation?
Well,
the current
before
model.
The Republic of Texas.
Right.
Oh, you're saying in the 2000s and 2100s here, yeah.
You're currently in the Republic of Texas. Is that correct?
Yeah. The what happened was, in the mid 1990s, some people who lived in Texas woke up from a long sleep.
Good
work. Kind of rose from the dead in a sense, like, because that. They realized, we are who we always were, you know. First you realize who you are. You're not a U.S. citizen. You are a flesh and blood human being, because a U.S. citizen is also considered a corporate entity. If you look in their laws, under the definitions, person means a corporation. So when your parents get a birth certificate for you, which is pushed by the hospitals, which are pushed by the government, that is their way of making you a corporate entity that belongs to the corporation called Texas and the corporation called U.S. Well, Texas is TX, so TX and U.S. own you because you're their person or corporation. So you're a corporation under the corporation called Texas, and Texas is a subcorporation under the corporation called U.S. Now, they can do anything with you that they want.
Who's the Corporation of United States of America registered under? Do you know?
Well, it's been incorporated four successive times. It's recorded as a corporation in Delaware. Where else? You know, that's where they'll make anything a corporation.
So it incorporates.
And it's on the record. You can go, you know, go to the. You can see where they were. They're also listed. You know, Dun & Bradstreet.
Yeah.
The U.S. government, the Texas government, and every part of them are listed and rated by Dun & Bradstreet.
Have you ever heard that we are listed there as well? It's
we who?
Well, I'm not necessarily pointing to you. I'm pointing to people that operate with a Social Security card.
Oh yeah. No, unless we're big enough, they don't bother with us.
Right.
Dun & Bradstreet only rates something that a lot of people would be interested in knowing, like the courts of the state of Texas are listed by Dun & Bradstreet.
Hmm. Makes sense. Yeah. They're there for profit, right?
Yeah. Now, the difference is both the Texas Corporation and the U.S. Corporation know darn well that we're also flesh and blood beings with a soul, you know, living souls. And so they try to keep that from coming to the table every way they can. for very good reasons. Understand? So this is all part of the charade that they're putting off on people.
And you've been involved for when did you wake up to the reality that everything wasn't quite the way that you were told?
Well, even before I moved to Texas, which is about 30 years ago, I woke up and realized someone wasn't right in the U.S., and I started checking it out and found out that they weren't really a government. Now, a lot of entities have studied this. The first thing to come to my attention was a 3/4 inch thick, 9x12 book put out by the American Farmers Association. They tried to figure it out, and they traced it back that the whole thing changed radically when the War Powers Act was misused to define everything, war and emergency powers as it was, to define everything as an emergency. And that was made rampant under FDR, Franklin Roosevelt, as president, so that whatever they wanted to do, they just called it a national emergency under War and Emergency Powers Act. And so we had a war on everything. You know, we've had a, what was the oldest one? It was a war on poverty, perhaps.
That's why we're
and you got a war. Yeah. Then you got a war on drugs. You got a war on terror now.
Right.
A war on obesity, you know. A war on tobacco. And that, in their book, gives them the authority to usurp even greater powers over us living souls and steal the freedoms that were guaranteed us as a republic and under the constitutions that they ignore. You know, the Constitution begins with the Bill of Rights. Well, actually, the Constitution was written first. And the states, who were nations at the time, said, no way are we going to ratify that sucker until we enumerate our unalienable rights. Actually, that's a mispronunciation. When it began, it was unalienable. No one can claim a lien against these rights. No one. Spelled the same way.
Okay.
And so it it's pronounced unalienable because the word alien started coming in there. Anyway, we have rights. First they're God-given, then they're enumerated, and then they said, you got to put these in there or we won't ratify the Constitution. So they are the beginning, you know. And in any case, they can't take them from us. What they do is just ignore it and say, that, and the cause of the current emergency, or for the greater good, we have to do this and this. We have to put little TV cameras, video cameras, in your cable box so that if necessary, we can see if you're a terrorist, you know, and on and on. And, of course, there are TV shows about all this intrusion on personal freedom and privacy.
Bob... Let me stop you right there.
Yes.
Where are we now? We live in occupied territory, per se. What next?
That's right.
What next?
I'm sorry, what's the question?
What next, now that we know that...
Well, what is next? Yeah, what is next? Well, what is next is we have sent formal notifications to the state of Texas government, By that I mean they're completely formal. They are sworn affidavits that are notarized and recorded in courthouses and then sent on. They have studiously ignored us because to answer us in any way gives an appearance of legitimacy to us. So it's like, you know, pay no attention to that man behind the curtain who was the Wizard of Oz. You know, it's that kind of treatment. Long term, a lot of things are happening. We're not sitting on our laurels at all. A lot of things are happening in every area. But, I mean, we have courts who hear cases and all that. They're common law courts. But what's going to happen is the Wizard of Oz is going to be exposed. You know, the emperor really doesn't have any clothes, which means in the current situation, the money that they claim is money is just paper and is becoming worthless. This week especially, the euro is going down the tubes because it doesn't, you know, it has no real value in it other than some International Monetary Fund claiming that it does. It's just a ledger entry. So when they can no longer pay the bills, when the state of Texas, getting back to where we are, can no longer pay their employees at all levels in any kind of currency that you can buy food with or pay rent with, those people will not come to work anymore because they're going to go plant gardens in their backyard. Am I right? Absolutely. And that's called hyperinflation. Now, there can be some deflation first, but that's just the good news before the bad news. Hyperinflation will come, and ultimately the governments will not be able to function because they can't get anybody to work or to do any services for them for hire. Then we have a government ready to move right on into the buildings, which are now vacant in Austin, Texas, and prevent anarchy. Because what's the greatest problem that happens when the government isn't functioning? All of the bad guys say, what an opportunity, I can become king of this thing. And we already know. So what you need is a fully functioning government in a hurry to prevent anarchy.
Oh, I totally understand that. I've actually wargamed that scenario in my head a few times, and I was very happy to find groups, and you guys in particular, in my case, the Republic of Texas, because you've been dealing with these issues since the 90s right now, the concepts, and you've done a lot of good homework.
Yeah.
I'm afraid we're out of time right now. We've been talking to Senator Bob Wilson from the Republic of Texas. This is Steve O'Brien from Occupied Fredericksburg. Bob, thank you very much.
Okay, thank you, Steve.